Good morning. Welcome, everyone, to Elm Street Congregational Church, United Church of Christ. I'm glad you've chosen to join us today as we worship the Lord together and have fellowship. The house of God is such a special place to be. You may have heard people refer to a church congregation as the body of Christ. This is because the Bible explains that we are, each individual, a part of one whole body, the body of Christ. For those of you watching our service on Facebook, welcome. We're glad you've joined us. Please sign in on the comment section, and if you have a prayer request or need to be contacted, let us know there as well. And I have some announcements today. The prayer meeting is every Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. on Zoom. If you need the link, see Pastor Kathy. The August mission of the month is school supplies for our local West Street school. The Way is our origins of Christianity as viewed by the early disciples. This is led by Marcy on Zoom Thursday evenings at 7 p.m. If you need that link, please reach out to her. The book study will return on August 8th. You'll be reading Jonathan Livingston Siegel by Richard Bach. Copies of the book can be picked up in the church office beginning July 16th. So that is a Thursday and it starts at 10:30. Okay. The annual church picnic is August 11th, that's next Sunday. There's a sign-up sheet in the vestry. We do need drinks and serving spoons. And everyone is asked to be there early. It starts at 10, but you need time to set up and get ready. So please get there early. Any questions? See Pastor Kathy.
I do need to count today. So if you haven't filled out anything on that sheet, tell me what your participation level is.
Okay, so if you haven't signed up on the sheet in the vestry, please do so today because we need an actual count of how many people are going so that we can get appropriate hot dogs and hamburgers. Two more announcements. A lunch bunch will be going to Francesco's on Friday, August 16th, and that's at noon. And Women's Fellowship is having a meeting after church in the vestry. We are restructuring Women's Fellowship. It is open to all people. We need to figure out what to do with our fellowship group going forward. So please join us in the vestry after church. Are there any other announcements? Okay, we'll continue with our morning prelude. Our morning call to worship. Please join me in the bold print. God desires truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart. God purges with hyssop, that we shall all be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit.
Our
Loving Trinity, your justice is the working out of your mercy and peace on earth. Nourish us with the power of the Son, and let us grow into his image and likeness. Humble us in our self-conceits so that we may act not arrogantly, but with humility, patience, forbearance, and love. Equip us for ministry on behalf of all who cry out to you. Help us to live lives worthy of the calling to which you have called us in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our opening hymn is in the Blue Hymnal 324, Christ High Ascending.
There is one body and one spirit, just as we were called to the one hope of our calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and parent of us all, who is above all and through all and in all. Though we seem so often to be tossed to and fro, blown about by every wind except that of God's Spirit, the Lord gathers us to lead a life worthy of our calling, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. For it is in that unity that we are equipped to grow up every way into Him who is the head, from whom we, Christ's body, are joined and knitted together. We are a part of this body. Let us together seek to grow in love.
God be with you. As we participate in the Lord's Supper, let us remember the great deeds that God has done. He created all the earth, stars, moon, and other celestial bodies from the chaos of the deep. He created the first people to care for the earth and each other.
How God walked with Abraham and Sarah and their descendants and called Moses through the burning bush. How God called forth prophets to guide the paths of the people and comfort them during the exile. God gave Torah for remembrance of his deeds.
And ultimately, God sent his love incarnate in a baby through a young woman named Mary. The baby's name was Jesus. He lived among us. He taught us to love. He reminded us that everyone has worth. But people were overcome and could not bear the message, and they gathered and shouted, "Crucify him."
But death could not hold him, and he resurrected on the third day and continued to teach until he ascended to heaven, leaving the seeds of love for others to carry on. We are descendants of those seeds.
Our Savior said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Christ invites us and all people to come to his table. Through the bread broken and the cup shared, the Lord meets us here with the gift of belief that by grace we may grow in love as the body of Christ, given for the life of the world. So on the night of the betrayal, Christ took the bread and he said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Eat, and as often as you eat of it, remember me." And he also took the cup of the new covenant and he said, "This is my blood poured out in a new covenant for you, and as often as you drink of it, remember me." So come, for our things are ready.
Of all.
This is the bread of life given us through Jesus Christ, God's love incarnate. Eat and remember. Said, "This is the blood for the new covenant poured out for you. Drink." Thank you, gentlemen. Oh, wait. Let us together say the prayer of thanksgiving. We thank you, God, for inviting us to this table where we have known the presence of Christ and have received all Christ's gifts. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and let us show forth your praise in our lives through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The worship God blesses is honest and personal, a broken and contrite heart. When we give of ourselves to God, our hearts are changed for good. Let us present tithes and offerings. We'll now collect our morning offering.
Your passion saves us from sin. Your power transfigures us into glory for you. Thank you for giving us a place in your good creation, for giving us the bread of heaven to free us from slavery to sin and death, and for filling us with the holy light of the gospel for the building up of Christ's body in love. We present offerings to praise you and help in the service of the church. Accept them as outward signs of our joyful discipleship. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord. Amen.
Our scripture reading this week is Ephesians 4, 1 through 16, Paul's letter to Ephesians. Therefore, the prisoners in the Lord beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, and with all humility and gentleness, with the patience bearing with one another, in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it is said, when he ascends on high, he made captive, he gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascends, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens, so that he might fill all the things. The gifts he gave were that of some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ until all of us come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to the maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth and building itself up in love.
Creator of unity, body of peace, spirit of community, bind us together around your word and send us out to do your justice, show your mercy, and embody your redeeming love, glorifying you, Holy Trinity. Amen. Our sermon hymn is All Praise to Our Redeeming Lord. You may stay sitting for this one. So the title of the sermon did not make the print cutoff. In fact, Hamer comes to me this morning and goes, what's the title of your sermon? I'm like, oh, I have to figure that out. But it's one for all and all for one. So if you know your Three Musketeers, you'll know that that is their saying, all for one and one for all. In a way, that is what we are as the body of Christ. Now, our passage this morning is unusual because it's Ephesians, and I rarely preach out of the letters. I like the Gospels. But this one made sense today because it talks about, it continues to talk about the things that we have been discussing lately, and that is, yes, we are called as individuals, and I firmly believe this, that each one of you is called as an individual to be a disciple of Christ. Now, we have to really broaden that understanding of Christ. Because Christ, the Messiah, according to Barth, who was a theologian from the 20th century, is God's love made manifest in a human. And in John, it tells us God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. And it's this love understanding of God that has been sent here to teach us. So with the broadest understanding of Christ, We can understand Christ as that which is God's love. Now, we have been taught, at least this is my observation, and maybe it's not yours, but I have noticed over the years that we are taught to keep religion to ourselves. Don't talk about religion, don't talk about politics, and that other thing that we don't talk about either. And we are taught that, and we have bought into that so much that we don't even really talk about it at church with each other. And we have done ourselves a great disservice. Now, I have been this way most of my life too. I don't go up to people in the supermarket and say, "Have you heard of Jesus?" Right? Because that would scare me. I'd be scared to do that, and it would probably make the other person think, "Oh, here's some weird woman with blue hair asking me if I know Jesus." So, what does that mean in broad terms? In broad terms, we are to be disciples of Christ. So that doesn't mean just followers. It means to be students of. That our life becomes transformed from the moment we hear that call until we are with all the saints in glory. Now, some of us hear a really clear call very early. Some of us don't. Some of us just get an inkling of a call. Some of us go, "I am not called." In fact, that was my song. I was not called to pastoring. I was called to the academic world. And I was very serious about that. Got 2 degrees, working on my PhD, and all of a sudden God said, no. And so I finally listened. I was like in my mid-30s, and I finally listened to, "All right, what do you want?" Not what do I want, but what do you want? And maybe you had that kind of conversation in your head with yourself. What is God calling me to do? Well, in our text today, is that God is calling us not to be that individual Christian that our society wants, who keeps their mouth shut, their head down, and they keep moving. You might check every once in a while. But God calls us to be the body of Christ so that we might equip the saints. Now, here's the thing. We are the saints. And we are called to equip each other, to bear each other's burdens, to bear the yoke of Christ. Now, we may not be particularly good at that, but we hear that and we allow ourselves to become transformed. And it's not, you're not transformed once and done, here's your stamp, you're done. It's like confirmation is not a graduation. It's a beginning of a journey to be in relationship not just with God through this love that is Christ, but with each other. Now, I think we do a pretty good job of that. I really do. I think we do a good job of listening and a good job of bearing one another's burdens and a good job of answering that call. So I know that many of you individually have answered that call and continue to answer it as you mature in the faith, as we mature in the faith, as I mature in the faith. And it brings us along to different understandings of the world. Because, you know, our world says that power and prestige are important. They're the ultimate thing. Chasing the dollar. Chasing power, being able to wield power over people. But God's love, that is Christ, has turned that upside down, has said no to that power structure and no to the wielding of power over people, and has turned that to a point where when we come to church, there should be no societal hierarchy. We are equal in the eyes of God. God gives us all grace and mercy and justice, and we are then asked to give that to one another also. So that means that oftentimes we have our feet stuck one world in the world and one foot in the kingdom of God. And as we mature and become adult Christians, we come to move more and more into the world of the kingdom and away from the world of society. Jesus did a lot while he was here on earth. He was a teacher and a healer. He was a friend. Some even say he was a comedian. Hey, hey, did you hear the one about the dumb shepherd? He was devout to the Father and spent a lot of time away from other people in communication with God, but he was always then again in communication with his disciples. So a lot of times in our world it says, I can have that connection to God, and that's appropriate, but my connection then of faith is not with other people. And there are folks, and I've been one of these folks at times in my life, when I said, I'm just going to stay home and be a Christian because the church is a bunch of hypocrites. And guess what? The church does have its share of hypocrisy. But by staying home, all I did was add to it and not pay attention to the transformation act of salvation. As individuals, we are called and we answer that call. And we don't answer that call to get a reward. We answer that call because God loves us, and that is our response to God's love. And in that, we are transformed, transforming. We're never done. We are transforming. And with that, then, our whole body of Christ, the whole congregation, is transformed. So that the body then equips us to do even more things in our Christian walk. So this passage, is trying to knit us together. And we've been opening church with binding us together. So the Greek word is katarisma, or katarismas. I'm not exactly sure how to pronounce that last part. And it means to knit, like bones knit together, to reconcile, to put back together. And that's what we need to do, not just with God and allow God to reconcile us to him, but allow ourselves to reconcile and knit together with each other. We are all imperfect critters. We just are. And from time to time, we will make boo-boos. And we will have to own up to them and apologize and seek forgiveness. That's okay, because that's how it goes when we're human. And so this is encouraging us as a body of believers, as disciples, to be in real relationship with one another. The kind where you sit down and you have a cup of coffee and a bagel. And we do a lot of that after church, but you are free to do that during the week too. It's not done on Sunday. And I know that some of you have been doing visitations and have been talking with others. And you know what? When we get to know each other, we can help support each other in our walk. When we get to know each other, we can cross boundaries and learn things that we didn't know, and our understanding of God and the world gets bigger. Because we are myopic. We start out with just tiny little dots of what we think things are, and they're like snapshots. And then we can move along to moving pictures. And then we can move along to more than one moving picture at a time. It takes a real ADD brain to do that well. So this is an encouraging passage that says we are to equip one another. It's not me equipping you. It's not you equipping me. It's we as the body. Now, yes, I am the lead disciple, and I get the office with the big chair, but it's us equipping each other for servanthood, for discipleship, to make this love incarnate in Christ a reality for as many people as we can possibly make it a reality for. Because knowing that you're loved, feeling that loved, is what brings a foretaste of God's kingdom. And it's God's kingdom that we pray for every Sunday when we pray for the Lord's, we pray the Lord's Prayer. So, let us continue to knit ourselves together, to build friendships, to show kindness and mercy and love and forgiveness. And it's fine to be happy and joyful and laugh with one another and tell jokes with one another. I have a great joke I'll tell you sometime about the golf ball and God and Jesus and Moses. It's awesome. So anyway, we are to be whole people of God. That means our whole selves. And our whole selves need to be reconciled with one another, to knit us together, to make us a bond. We know the disciples tried doing that, and it's not easy. Sometimes there was little snippinesses between the disciples and who gets to do what. But we know that God calls us and that God loves us and that we are together with God. Would you pray with me? Holy God, our Father and our Mother, we thank you for one for all and all for one. We ask that you be with us each day, that you help us to be kind, to reconcile ourselves to our brothers and sisters, to share our burdens, to listen, to really hear what's going on in the lives of our neighbors, our congregants, of the other parts of the body of Christ, so that we might hold one another up. We thank you, Lord, for your call to us and for allowing us to respond in the positive and for bringing transformation into our lives, into this body of Christ, and into the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Is it up there? No. I'll get another pair. All right. Joys and concerns this morning. Yes. Jeff. Okay. What is the name of the lady again?
Karen.
Larry. Sue. How's she doing? Okay. John. Okay. So I would like to share joy. Last week on Sunday, Eric asked me about a confirmation class for his daughter. And I thought about it and I prayed about it and I called some people. I called Jessica and I called Chris and Hendrix, and I said, well, what do you think about getting together and doing a confirmation class? We prayed about it in our prayer group on Wednesday. So I'd like you to go home and pray about this, because it would be a whole church confirmation. Like, the adults need to be participating in this too. And it should be uplifting and fun and full of the Spirit. And it should allow all of us, adults included, to consider how Christ has been working in our lives and to be able to share that with each other. So would you pray for that this week? Anything else? All right. Holy God, our Father and our Mother, we lift up all in our congregation who are homebound or sick. We lift up those who have MS, and we lift up Mary Ellen particularly. We lift up Karen and Peter and Tony. And everyone who has medical issues or is homebound. And we call for families to return to church. And that doesn't mean return to a building. That means spiritually return as disciples. We pray, Lord, that you will be with us in our walk. And thank you for the blessings that you've given us. Amen.
Please join me in the responsive prayer. Join me in the bold print. God of all goodness and grace, you desire truth in the inward being. Search our hearts as we seek after you and receive our prayers in your mercy and love. Have mercy upon this world, O God. We pray for leaders and those in positions of power, that they may be guided by your truth and attentive to the needs of your people. We pray for those whose voices have been silenced, those unjustly separated from loved ones, and those who are hungry, homeless, or hopeless. Have mercy upon your church, O God. We pray for those who are seeking, yet know not for which they seek. We pray that you would make your church humble, gentle, and patient, living a life worthy of its calling. Equip the saints for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ. Have mercy upon our hearts, O God. We pray for those who have heard hard truths of illness, loss, or disrupted dreams, for those who have heard false words of hate or harm, unwelcome or denial. We pray that you would cleanse our lives of anything that displeases you, whether done to us or by us. By your abundant mercy and steadfast love, O God, receive our prayers and embolden all people to recognize and celebrate the gift of your Spirit in one another. Satiate our needs with that which you alone can offer, and direct our longing toward that which is true. Through Christ our Lord, amen. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is in the blue hymnal, number 581, called as Partners in Christ's Service.
So please stay.